Thank you very much for having me on the webinar today. And of course, Dr. Bhandari sir has, you know, set the tone so well for the topics we are going to cover. And of course, as usual, they are just, his talks are always, you know, soul fulfilling. It's just so lovely whatever he talks about. And I absolutely share my thoughts about whatever he has said. And it's so true that no virus is going to enter our body, or no disease causing organism will enter our body unless and until we allow that microorganism to enter our body by having a weak immunity. So exactly that is what my talk is about, on how we are supposed to use diet and exercise to build health and immunity. So this is the unfortunate case in India these days. We can see by this simple slide as how much increase in lifestyle diseases has happened in our country in the past 50 years. And the most worrisome aspect is that it is actually hitting people even at the young ages of 30 and above. In my clinical practice also as a radiologist, when I did my radiology way back in 1998, fatty liver was it maybe 1 in 100 patients we used to, even more than that, and it was said to be a disease of the elderly, that if it's a 60-year-old woman presenting with fatty liver and then most probably having gallstones and all that along with it. However, the scary thing is that a fatty liver is being diagnosed in even 20 years old. And these are all these minor indications of the fact that we are sitting on a ticking time bomb of a metabolic syndrome. And how do we tackle these lifestyle diseases on the rise? As we can see, there is this gentleman sitting here on a sofa and he's just, you know, mindlessly binging. And how do we tackle it? It's diet. And that's what will lead to ultimately good health. Good health is equal to immunity. So this, basically, what does good health means? Good health means that we are strong and we are immune. I'm repeating this slide of mine because I'm really fond of this slide. And really, I mean, are you kidding me? What is happening? How are we evolving? Look at what's happening in the series of evolution. From being one of those strong hunter-gatherer men, we have evolved to this person who is morbidly obese and mindlessly eating, binging, junking with no awareness of health, whether it's physical or mental health whatsoever. So coming back to where I was talking about health and what exactly is health. Now these are two definitions. One is lifespan and one is health span. Lifespan has been increased to quite some certain extent thanks to our increase in our medical aid, increase in all the medicines, hospitals. We have huge, big five-star hospitals everywhere, and there is no dearth of medications. For every little thing, we are bombarded with medicines. But now here is the important thing. What is our health span? What are the number of days in our life when we can truly say that we have been healthy? We have not needed the help of a medicine to, you know, whether it's a medicine for a headache or it's a medicine for joint pains, backache, heart health, hypertension, diabetes. What is that, those number of days in our life when we have, can say that truly we are healthy? And that's now the word which is of paramount importance, not the lifespan, but the health span. So in very short, about our ancestors of before agriculture, where we can see that where it all started, the human civilization, from the hunter-gatherers and the Paleolithic era, where we were strong, we were healthy, and we were looking into whole, clean, unprocessed foods. Of course, there were the use of animals, seasonal vegetables, fruits, and nuts, none of those which were genetically modified. Then came the use of fire. Then came the agriculture and the Neolithic era, which led to grain cultivation and the domestication of animals for dairy. And then came the modern civilization, in which the face of nutrition as was known completely changed. And how and why did it change? Because there it started into the food politics, the manufacturing, and that was when the standard food pyramid became the way it is, just as I am showing, that the food pyramid showed us that the carbohydrates were the predominant part of the food we are eating. Then came the fruit and vegetable, then came the protein, and the least and the most scariest element which was targeted was the fat. The tragic part of the standard food pyramid is that the carbohydrates were replaced from being the complex carbohydrates, which are a source of sustained and slow energy release in our body, were actually replaced by what we can see all over here, the refined carbohydrates, which gave us to a sudden shoot in our blood sugar, leading to release of insulin. And we all know this is predominantly where most of the lifestyle diseases started occurring. So what happened? What is the problem then? So, well, this is a simple triangle which I've borrowed from a friend of mine, and he's a doctor working a lot on the field of the food and medicine and nutrition, where we can see that these are disease triangles, where we can see environment, lifestyle, the lipidology, the immunology. All of these are linked together with the genetics to ultimately decide on what and how we are supposed to be healthy. What really happened when we were bombarded with the junk food, with refined carbohydrates, full with the sugar in various names whatsoever, the lethal carb addiction cycle started. So we were eating a lot of refined and processed carbs, thanks to the advertisement being bombarded on us the whole time, which led to high blood sugar, insulin release, which led to body fat production. The blood sugar dipped and the craving started occurring all over again. So we are all very familiar with the carb craving. We can have a nice heavy breakfast full of refined carbohydrates, and we experience a sugar crash by 12 at 12 o'clock, where is it is the chai time in all the offices. So it is the chai samosa time in all the offices. These days it's replaced by some other junk food which is available in all the cafeterias. So then we all have our chai, or we have the sugar fulfill cold coffees, or the juices full of sugar and something to eat with it. And we slowly struggle back into work. Then we again have a crash at lunchtime. We again have a lot of refined carbs in some form or the other, some fast food, junk food, burgers, chips, Pepsi, all of these things, colas. Then we again have a crash at 4 or 5 o'clock. So it's the constant day just goes by in the sugar rising and crashing and rising and crashing, and ultimately leads to insulin resistance. So we are seeing this is the typical kind of a junk food which most of us are eating these days. So that's a cold soft drink, or some kind of a juice. Those are fries, that's a burger, and this is what we are having for for our meals most of the time. All it does is leads to a constant high in the of glucose in the blood, leads to a constant insulin demand. Whereas when the receptors become, because of this whole gamut of biochemical reactions happening, ultimately the cells become insulin resistant, which leads to starvation amidst plenty. Even though there is a high glucose level, the cells are not able to utilize, which leads to increased insulin, leads to deposition of body fat. This leads to further hunger, further craving, and we all know that this is associated with all the possible lifestyle diseases we can think of. So basically, I always say that this is starvation amidst plenty. We are eating plentiful of food, yet we are constantly and perpetually starved. Because this most of it is, of course, we all know that there is a lot of other hormones, bioregulatory mechanisms, and so much more associated with all of this. But the primary hormone of importance is the insulin and the insulin receptors. So this regulates energy and the energy storage. when dietary carbohydrates, which is the primary food fuel, turns on the insulin, these are what it turn on the insulin switch, the carbohydrates, whereas the proteins also turn on the insulin switch, but to a lesser extent, and the dietary fats to hardly an extent. What are the normal functions of the insulin receptors? So these act on the cells, muscles, tissues to absorb energy and nutrients. The excess food energy, which is not really utilized, is converted to fat and stored. Normally, the insulin will suppress the appetite and decrease when thanks to the nutritional therapy, we have decreased insulin, then it promotes the release of the stored energy. So this is how the basic mechanism of type 2 diabetes happens, that ultimately when the cells become insulin resistant, we are unable to utilize the energy, and after a while the pancreas starts, the amount of insulin produced by the pancreas also starts reducing, and that is when the full-blown type 2 diabetes, the patient lands up into full-blown type 2 diabetes and will ultimately have to lead a lifetime of his life with the health span is gone completely for a toss. The lifespan may increase, but the quality of life goes for a complete toss. Some simple simple things which we should all observe, whether we are not getting pre-diabetic or, as I spoken previously, carbohydrate intolerant. These are simple things. Are you feeling tired and sleepy? Is there a lot of blurred vision, very thirsty or acetone smelling breath? If it's confusional state, stomach cramps, or just feeling of nausea or feeling of being sick, feel the need to urinate all the time, and of course, high blood sugar. From diabetes, we are coming to obesity, because all of these are linked. You know, you can, though there is a great predominance of normal body weight diabetic population, especially in the men, because we know that men tend to store a lot of visceral fat, a lot of belly fat, and now actually there is quite a rise in men having a normal so-called body weight, that is when they climb on the weight machine. The body weight is normal, the BMI is normal, yet they have underlying visceral fat and they are pre-diabetic, they have fatty liver, they are having a high triglyceride level, and they are sitting on a poor health span parameters. Now coming to obesity, which is it's a really slow chronic metabolic disease. And in COVID times, we have seen that obesity, diabetes, and hypertension, these were the three major comorbid factors involved with COVID-19. And how tragic can this be, that it's a chronic metabolic lifestyle disease, and it's reached such hazardous levels that the virus found a beautiful way to enter the bodies and create complete havoc in those systems. And as we know that the fat cells are responsible for all of these, thanks to the various biochemical and biophysiological regulatory mechanisms going on, from dyslipidemia to hypertension to premature aging, insulin resistance, type 2 diabetes, various thrombosis going on in the body, metabolic syndrome, atherosclerosis, cancer, inflammation, autoimmune disease, allergies, you name it, and it's thanks to the underlying obesity and the underlying high insulin resistance. I think this is a slide which I have repeated again, and I'm just putting it in between because it's again something we have to understand. Please somehow make a mental and visual image of this slide, because this is extremely important. Why we are fat and hungry, and why are we starving amidst a plenty? So that's what I had said previously, that this is a so-called light lunch, which we all claim to have. We had a very light lunch. We just had a sandwich. So, well, this is what the sandwich, the processed and the refined flours in the sandwich does. And please be very careful of all the so-called brown bread, especially available in India. And if you are carbohydrate intolerant, if thanks to having a lot of carbohydrates most of your life and now you are touching 30 or 40 years of age and you are already carbohydrate intolerant, then even a really whole grain, multi-grain bread might lead to the rise in insulin, which will make your fat cells grow larger. Then again, the same thing, not enough calories left in the bloodstream, and brain then constantly tells you to eat more. So is this you? Are you having all of these? These are all the signs of carbohydrate intolerance, from fatigue to cravings for sugar to fatigue after meals to a lot of fibromyalgia. Fibromyalgia is now so much on the rise, chronic aches and pains of all over the body. People are getting MRIs done for the low back pains. People are getting every possible investigation done, and ultimately we realize it's fibromyalgia. Of course, the major there are two components, and one is the stress component and the other is insulin resistance. So polycystic ovary disease, it's another disease which we had never heard of 50 years prior. It was very hardly seen maybe 50-60 years before, and now it is absolutely hyperinsulinemia of the ovaries, and a lot of association with in insulin resistance is seen in all those young teenagers having PCOD. And of course, the high triglycerides, all of these. Is this you? I hope it is not. To all of the attendees who are watching this webinar today, please see this slide very carefully. Maybe you could just click a photograph of this slide and look into it. I hope this is not you. And again, another slide I have borrowed from a friend of mine, that these are all six dysfunctional pathways which are leading to aging, premature aging. We are finding something called premature aging these days. Again, the lifespan is increasing, but there is a huge element of premature aging, which is glycation, oxidative stress, inflammation, mitochondrial dysfunction, insulin and leptin resistance, and membrane instability. And all the problems are not, forgive me for the spelling error, are not actually need medicine. They all can be reversed by proper food. This is a very nice slide I came across, an excerpt from Obesity and its Treatment in 1882. Where Professor Dr. Wilhelm Epstein said that fatty foods are crucial because they increase satiety. Avoid sugar, avoid sweet, avoid potatoes, limit bread and vegetables. Meat of every kind can be eaten, especially fatty meal. However, suddenly there was this whole spurt where they said that move into polyunsaturated fatty acids, move into vegetable oils, and the low-fat, high-carbohydrate diet, and that led to an explosion of metabolic syndrome and diabetes. My primary area of interest is the therapeutic reduction of carbohydrates. This is primarily if you are a carbohydrate intolerant, you are facing a pre-metabolic syndrome or pre-diabetic, and let us see how much of carbohydrates you are eating in your day-to-day life. And we are surprised to see that people are eating more than 200 grams of carbohydrates in their day-to-day lives, very deficient in protein with hardly any fat there in their diet. There, all of these various diet plans have been doing the rounds. This is the Mediterranean food pyramid, where they focus upon whole grains, fruit, vegetable, a lot of seafood, a lot of poultry, eggs, cheese, yogurts, and nuts and seeds. Then this is a raw food pyramid, which is the vegan diet. All of these diets are, you know, become really popular these days. This is the low carb food pyramid, where we are set to focus more on the meats, eggs, cheese, the fats, and the non-starchy vegetables and the fibrous food. Again, coming to the ketogenic diet, which is also called the low carb, high fat diet. So this is the keto food list. And so these are all those various diet things, which are the paleo diet. which are you know doing their rounds. So many more of them in India. There's so much, like the fruit diet, the khichdi diet, the all sorts of diets everywhere. The what predominantly what is the factor involved with all the diets is to therapeutically lower your carbohydrates to a level which is suitable for your own self. For instance, patient A, who leads a very active lifestyle, whose blood sugars, whose fasting insulin is perfectly normal, who's maybe a gymmer, an avid fitness enthusiast, or who's maybe a marathon runner, can be allowed a particular amount of carbohydrates versus patient B, who is a sedentary person who wakes up in the morning, does maybe about half an hour of yoga or maybe nothing at all, and goes to the office, works on his seat for 8 to 10 hours, comes back home, does a sedentary half an hour walk, goes off to sleep. Well, what will those carbohydrates do to that person? And that person is a pre-diabetic, his HbA1c is borderline, his triglycerides are elevated, his fasting insulin is elevated. So for that person, would maybe start looking into going from a low carbohydrate diet perspective to a keto diet. And these are all names for the same thing. It's ultimately therapeutic reduction of carbohydrates. It's all a gimmick which all these different names have been giving. Again, there's a whole spurt of dirty keto. With dirty keto, I mean snacks. Keto snacks have been started, I've suddenly seen keto snacks are available all over the place. Oh, well, therapeutic reduction of carbohydrates or a keto diet or a low carb diet does not at all talk about eating any sort of packaged food. It tells you to, number one, fast, which is intermittent fasting, which is basically therapeutic eating and timing of your food. So number one, it talks about fasting, and number two, it talks about resting, which Dr. Avantina will be tackling, how to reduce your cortisol levels. It does not at all talk about eating any sort of packaged food, whether in the name of keto, whether in the name of any health food. Move to real food, move to the food which nature has given us, whether you are a non-vegetarian or you're a vegetarian, yet move to real food. There is just no need for you to go to a market or a supermarket and buy those packaged so-called snack, whether it's written in big letters it's a healthy snack. There is something very favorite of mine, which I try to educate all my patients, that if it is written on the packet, packaged life, 2 years, kindly stay away from that. If the bacteria and the fungus are not going to grow in that food, which has a packaged life of 2 years or even 6 months, means that the nutritional content is zero and the chemical content and the preservative content is extremely high. Move to eating real food which nature has given us. Now coming to the everything which people want to know, how do we lose weight? Everybody is very bothered about losing weight. Again, I always say the weight loss is a byproduct of gaining your health. The moment you gain back your health, the weight will slowly and steadily come down. And this is something which has been told to all of us, which was told to me all my life, how do you lose weight? Eat less, move more, and combine, a combination of both, that you exercise more, eat less. And well, yes, in a way, this is right. But now what kind of exercise and what kind of food? Do we really think that the quality of the calories matter? The quality of this burger, whether you might just have this burger and say that, okay, I had this burger, this was 500 calories, and now I'm not going to eat anything. Do you really think that the quality of the 500 calories in this burger is equivalent to the quality of 500 calories you can take from a meal of eggs or a meal of paneer or a meal of quinoa salad or a meal of green vegetables with olives and eggs thrown in? Absolutely not. Because those are the calories which will make you immune, your immunity better, your insulin lower, your body to be healthier, whereas these are nutritionally trash calories. So number one, what are the quality of calories you are intaking? And number two, what is the exercise you are doing? Now, so this is a simple thing, whereas, you know, what a cold coffee in Starbucks will burn 16 minutes of calories. This is a chart which is, you know, everybody follows. So you have 3 Oreo cookies and you walk for 30 minutes. Is it valid? Do you really think you have McDonald's fries of 370 calories and you walk for 1 hour and it's over and done with? So that's a question I'm throwing out to the audience. Do you really think this chart is of any use after all what I've spoken? And now the science is in. Exercise won't really help you lose much weight. What will the exercise do? Exercise will improve your immunity. It will increase your endorphins. It will make you fit. It will improve your cardiovascular endurance. It will make you, your mitochondria strong. It will help you in fight inflammation. It will lower your insulin resistance, but it will really not help you lose much of weight. It's almost 80-20. According to me, it's actually 90-10, where it's 10% of the exercise, which is important, and 90% of the food we eat. And all around us, we must be seeing cyclists, marathon runners, gymmers who are intensely working out and yet have the belly fat or yet are, you know, pretty much obese and not what you would call in the healthy range. So this is what is very important. This is the most important thing, sleep and stress management, which Dr. Avantina will be talking about. Most important is how we are sleeping, how we are resting, how low our cortisol is, and yes, the quality of exercise. Then comes the intermittent fasting, how, when, and how long. Now comes the food, what foods you are eating and what, how they work for you. Then the macros, your protein, carbohydrates, and fat. And the least important is the calorie in, calorie out concept. What are the types of exercises? Cardio, strength training, flexibility, and corrective. So these are, I have taken the liberty to share my own photographs, as I, everybody knows, I'm an avid runner and an avid fitness enthusiast. So cardio, according to me, even though I'm a marathon runner, makes just about 5% of the exercise, which if you are looking into exercise as a therapy. Of course, cardio is important for your physical endurance. So you could just throw in moments of running, jogging, walking. HIIT training, rather than just running or jogging at a constant pace, I believe in throwing in spurts of sprints, whether they are sprints of 50 minutes or even up to 50 meters or up to 200 meters. That really works in getting the insulin resistance down. Weight training is of great importance and mandatory. It's actually, now I use the word mandatory both for men and women, to boost not only health, immunity, lower the insulin levels, and as well as boost the testosterone levels, which is again essential, of course, in men, even in women, and to prevent osteoporosis. Flexibility. Both these exercises without flexibility, well, you are sitting on a time bomb of injuries. Believe me, I have had my real share of injuries, because this is how I started. I started with running, I moved into weight training, and I really never gave flexibility much of an importance. But now I do my yoga, I do my Pilates at least twice a week to build as much flexibility as possible. And now we come to the corrective exercises. If you have pulled a muscle, if you have had an injury, then please cut back on the rest of exercises and first focus on the corrective exercises. This is when I was training for a marathon and I ended up getting a very bad piriformis injury. It's a small muscle in your butt. And so this is the corrective exercises which I had been asked to do, and it helped me. It regained my strength back, and I still do all of these exercises. So I have divided my exercise schedule into following all of these according to a particular time frame. So this is again another slide where you could, these are flexibility exercises. These are the aerobic exercises, cycling, swimming, which help in building cardiovascular fitness and endurance. And anaerobic exercises where it comes the weight training and sprinting. Sprinting again from 50 meters to 200 meters. It will really help you in getting your insulin levels down and your endurance up. So in the end, it's all about the nutrition and the metabolism. We have to understand all macronutrients are not created equal. Carbohydrates, especially the refined and tricarbohydrates, the junk food, that's completely have to throw it out of your house. They are fattening and inflammatory, and the fats and the protein have to be used in a personalized approach. And you have to keep in mind that insulin, that obesity is a chronic metabolic disease thanks to insulin resistance and inflammation. A word of caution, because I am extremely passionate about childhood obesity. All of those who know me well know that I was a fat child and I was a fat teenager. So all my life I've struggled against poor metabolic health. All those mothers, all those ladies who are watching me today, please find other ways to show love to your children. The love should not be shown through food alone. I've seen a lot of my patients who are following very, very good diet plans given by me, but then they are feeding their children all sorts of junk food, from the soft drinks to pizzas to burgers. So well, please build up their immunity right from the beginning. Let the child grow into a healthy individual. Again, sharing some few food items which I make at home myself to just, you know, try to put the point across that it's a lifestyle change we are talking into. This is a gluten-free low-carb roti which I have made using almond flour, flaxseed flours, some amount of millet flours thrown in. Again, this is some paneer and some beetroot salad. This is a chicken casserole. This is again paneer with dal, and as you can see, the roti is not needed at all on this plate, and some green herb chutney for the micronutrients. This is a foxtail millets khichdi, which I really love, and it helps me especially when I'm running. So all the millets are also not equal. Some millets like foxtail and barnyard are lower in carbohydrates. Again, this is a tikki, a paneer and mincemeat tikki. This is again the flaxseed almond flour roti. And this is a coconut hunker dip. And this is the most interesting thing. This is cauliflower rice. So just substitute your rice with cauliflower rice. It tastes so good. It's so yummy. So the last word, that the common links between all these diets are that they all look into real high quality food. Keto, paleo, Mediterranean, etc., all the diet plans are relevant only when they manipulate carbohydrates. Any diet which tells you to snack frequently, to eat frequently, to go low on protein, to go low on good quality fats, avoid such diets. You need to eat in a way that is sustainable in long term, so that you have to understand, because it's a lifestyle, it's not a diet we're talking about. You have to find out together with your personal, with a doctor, with a person who is looking into nutrition as a form of medicine, to see what works too for you. Everybody is different. And you have to recognize that what you eat can have an incredibly powerful effect on your health. So thank you very much.